Motorturbo phone patch. Before we begin looking at the CPS, let me show you the diagram of a typical Motorturbo phone patch system. So essentially our infrastructure would consist of our Motorturbo repeater. So this could be the DR3000 or MTR3000. Then connected to this repeater on the back through the accessory connector or through the system connector would be a standard phone patch device. So whoever you know who makes phone patches, for example, Zetron, you have this box, this third-party box that you would call the phone patch. So there are many manufacturers of them. It's up to you what to use. The phone patch would connect into the phone line. This could be a PSTN or PABX. The connection is straightforward analog. So this phone patch hardware essentially is a reuse of existing analog hardware. All we have done in Motorturbo phone patch is enable the digital capabilities as well as some additional calling features. So let's have a look at what would happen, for example, if a user were to make a phone call. And when we say user, we mean a telephone user. What would happen if they had to make a phone call? So firstly, they would dial the telephone number of the phone patch. This would be a regular telephone number. That's all handled by the PABX or telephone exchange. So what happens is the call arrives at the phone patch, it would ring, so it would present a ring voltage to the phone patch device. The phone patch device would answer the call and put the, let's say, audio from the phone line through to the Motorturbo repeater. Now, some phone patches have the ability for things like voice prompts. So instead of hearing a beep or a click, the phone patch would say, "Please dial the number required." Now, the person on the phone line would have to dial an additional number, and this number would essentially consist of the radio ID, but it would consist of also some, let's say, call steering parameters. So these would include, in, let's say, for example, single site or in IP site connect, the slot, as well as a steering digit identifying what type of call it is. So, is this a group call or is this a private call? Because in Motorturbo, you can have, for example, radio ID 1 for an individual radio and group ID 1 for a group call. So, the group call, the private call could potentially have the same number, and that is why from the phone line we need this steering digit, let's say. In a capacity plus system, if this Motorturbo repeater here were configured for capacity plus operation and the radios would be running capacity plus, then you wouldn't need the digit to identify which slot this call should go on because the slot is assigned dynamically by the radio system. Okay, let's have a look now at what would happen if a radio user wanted to make a phone call. So, in the configuration of the radio would be a gateway ID. And this gateway ID would be the radio ID of the repeater. So, when we come to see the CPS, we'll see inside the CPS that there is this radio ID. And in the past, it was purely used to identify the repeater to the network, the IP site connect or capacity plus network. Now, this radio ID is used to identify where the, let's say, telephone call should be routed to on the phone line. So the radio user would make a phone call, and the phone call would consist of a number of DTMF digits. These DTMF digits would be transferred to the phone patch. So what would happen is the radio makes the phone call, it establishes an air interface call between the repeater and the radio using the phone patch connection. It sends the number dialed to the repeater. The repeater then takes that number to be dialed, gives it to the phone patch, and the phone patch would then in turn pass, put that on the phone line, and it would be a call setup. But in order to get this phone patch effectively to pick up the line, to grant access to the user to the phone line, there needs to be what we call an access code. So traditionally on an analog phone patch system, this would be like a secret PIN or something like that to prevent users who are not allowed to have phone privileges to access the phone line. In phone patch in Motor Turbo, we have more or less the same feature. So you have to dial this access code. The access code gets the phone patch to connect you through to the phone line. So once you've done all that, the call goes ahead, and when you're finished, the radio can either end the call by pressing a button or by sending, or specifically sending, the D-access code. And the D-access code basically tells the phone patch to terminate the call, to drop the line. Coming to the CPS, I'm going to open a code plug here of a Motor Turbo repeater. So here I have a code plug of a DR3000. Now, let me show you some of the parameters here. Firstly, the first thing that we need to look at here is the firmware version. The repeater has to have a version R01.08.00 or later in order for phone patch to work. So that's like the basic requirement. Secondly, what needs to happen is that the phone patch feature has to be purchased, and this is done through licensing. When the phone patch feature is purchased, what you will notice is in the code plug you have an additional field, an additional window here called phone system, and there are some additional fields in the channel configuration of the repeater. So let's start off by looking at what are the important points that we need to program into this repeater in order for phone patch to work. So starting at the beginning, at the top, radio name, what I like to put in here is I like to put in the site name and the channel number. Then what that does is when you access this repeater through RDAC, instead of seeing some nondescript name, for example Motorola or whatever, you actually have the site name, so it kind of makes it a little bit more user-friendly. Very important, radio ID. When we come to program the radio, this is the gateway ID, and it's very important that this number is unique. So here we have got radio ID 1. It means that on the air interface, on the radio side, portables and mobiles, we cannot use that number. That number has to be unique throughout the system. The range for that number, by the way, is like from 1 to 16 million, so you will virtually not run out of radio IDs for repeaters. The second thing which is very important is here under accessories. When you upgrade to release 1.8 or firmware version R01.08. You obviously get additional features, and one of them that you need to set in this radio is this setting here, and this relates to the accessory connector. Now you need to be very careful. You need to set here on one of the pins the function carrier operated relay. Now some people make a mistake and they select CSQ detect, carrier squelch detect. The name you need to be very careful about, because the CSQ detect is a little bit more, let's say, misleading. You have to select carrier operated relay, and these two functions work differently in that carrier operated relay is tied to the phone patch. CSQ detect and other pins are not tied to the phone patch. So what you could notice is that if you don't set carrier-operated relay, you can't make phone calls from the radio to the phone line. That part will not work. The other thing that you need to be careful about is the active level. So this is a phone patch dependent feature and essentially determines whether you have what we used to call positive or negative logic. That means if carrier-operated relay is active, the line will go low. The other one is on here, it's shown on pin 17, external mic PTT. So again, this line, you trigger it and it will cause the repeater to PTT. Since this is an input, the function here, debounce, is enabled, the same for here. And debounce, as the name suggests, is debounce protection. So if you want to know what that does, read it up, how it works. So again, here we have active level, and this would depend on what model of phone patch you have. Some require active level higher, some require active level low. So it could be anything. So continuing, you would need to set some things relating to privacy. You would need to set some things relating to IP Side Connect or Capacity Plus in terms of IP addressing. Now, coming to a phone system. So here we have to put some parameters in. The first of these is what we call the deaccess code. So this is the DTMF tones that the radio must send to the phone patch or to the repeater to tell it to disconnect, to hang up. So the deaccess code could be anything. You could put in whatever you want here, 0 hash. So it'll be 0 to 9 star and hash, standard DTMF tones. Busy timeout timer. So this is the amount of time that the repeater will put the phone call on hold before it times out. So imagine you have a channel, you dial into the channel is busy because you're wanting to make a private call and it's busy with another call, for example. What that will do is it'll say, okay, right, well, the channel is busy, it will wait 15 seconds and it'll say, sorry, can't connect you, and hangs up. Obviously, you have to dial in a few minutes' time when the channel is free, perhaps. Another timer here is response timeout timer. So again, it's related to if the channel is busy. What will happen is if you want to make a private call to a radio, the radio has to acknowledge this private call. And if no acknowledgement is received from that radio within, in this case, 18 seconds, the phone patch, or at least the repeater, will tell the phone patch, sorry, can't connect, and hangs up. TX tone duration, TX tone interval, these are the parameters for DTMF. So in this case here we have DTMF tone duration of 100 milliseconds and 60 milliseconds gap between each tone. Enable all call. So here we say, do we want to give the phone user the ability to make all call? So this would be a one-way announcement call to every single radio on the system. Response required. If we put a tick there, what that does is that when we make a private call to a particular radio, that radio should acknowledge this call setup and then the call is established. So what we're doing is we're checking to see that the target radio is available before we set up the call. So it's related to this setting here, the response timeout timer. So here what happens is that we try to call a radio, the radio doesn't respond, the phone patch will wait, in this case 12 seconds, no answer, it ends the call. Target ID length. This is the length of the radio's ID, and that target ID is made up of the radio ID plus the slot plus the call type digit. So here we have 6 digits. So one digit is for the call type, one digit is for the slot, and the remaining 4 digits would be allocated to the radio ID. Entry time, so this is the amount of time that a telephone user has to enter a particular target ID before it's validated or invalidated. And here we're saying how many times are you allowed to enter a wrong target ID. So I put in target ID, it's wrong. It doesn't exist, that radio is not there, or the group is not there, whatever. The repeater bleats at me and says, beep, sorry, enter it again. I enter the digits again, and if I don't get it right after 3 times, or I enter the wrong digits 3 times, then the repeater will tell the phone patch, end the call. Okay, coming down to the channels, now there's 2 possibilities. There is, of course, the digital possibility, and there is, of course, capacity plus. So looking at digital mode, all the other parameters are exactly the same. The only thing that you will see is different here for IP site connect is that you have the ability to select which slot the phone gateway should be on. So slot 1 or slot 2 or both. For capacity plus, the same thing. You have a drop down, either none or slot 1 and slot 2. You can't have that it's only on slot 1 or only on slot 2, because capacity plus is independent of which slot it is. It's the slot and the channel it is assigned by the system dynamically.